Welcome to part three of Jazz from Its Origins to the Present. Today we're going to be talking about jazz in the 20s. It was well established in New Orleans, and it developed many different groups like the King Oliver Jazz Band and Louis Armstrong. Many young musicians, including white musicians, started to incorporate this style of jazz playing. In fact, the 20s was often referred to as the jazz age, or the age of jazz, and there were featured music that was lively dance music in the time period when they actually had prohibition in this country, the amendment that banned the use of alcohol. So there were a lot of underground clubs that were developed, and the music reflected this kind of wild and crazy style of music that was being performed at this time. Since New York was known as the home of the music publishing business, it was also the place where many musicians ended up. They came from New Orleans, went to Chicago, and often went to New York then, especially in Manhattan, where there were lots of different nightclubs and underground venues for these bands to play. Despite the benefits of the 18th Amendment that were presumed, it created lots of crime in the various cities where the crime bosses started to take over, and there was actually an underground jazz culture, and they would play in places called speakeasies, which were hidden rooms and other areas in basements of restaurants and other buildings, and the jazz musicians were forced basically underground. One of the famous jazz performers was James P. Johnson. He created a special piece of music called the Charleston, which was very typical of this particular type of music in this jazz age. Another famous musician of this time period was Bix Beiderbecke. He was around the Chicago area and created lots of memorable styles following in the pathway of many of the previous artists that had gone before him, like King Oliver and Louis Armstrong. His parents wanted him to be anything but a musician, but he couldn't help himself and really developed a great style of music. Bix joined a small group led by musician Frankie Trumbauer and played some musical examples, including this one that we're going to listen to now briefly, called Singing the Blues. Another musician of this time was Red Nichols. He introduced rhythmic changes in the music and also added whole tone scales. Red Nichols actually created more recordings than Louis Armstrong in the early days, and he recruited many of the most famous white musicians of the time. He also created a unique voice-like sound for his recordings. In New York City, there was another style of piano playing called stride piano. This derived from some of the earlier ragtime traditions and incorporated a strong left hand solid beat along with extreme syncopation in the right hand. One of the proponents of this style was James P. Johnson. We mentioned earlier that he wrote a piece called The Charleston, and we're going to listen to that at this time. The next musician we're talking about is Earl Hines. He was actually part of an important group of Eastern pianists that created a unique piano style using octaves so that he could cut through the band sound and be heard with his piano playing. He also used a tremolo effect, which is kind of a shaking of the melody line, and some other unique vibrato type of effects that were often used by instrumentalists like the trumpet players. He did work with Louis Armstrong and created some various recordings for OK Records in 1928. Edward Duke Ellington was known for creating about 1,000 different compositions and actually won a Presidential Medal of Honor in his career also. He was so well known with his music, including pieces like In a Sentimental Mood or Mood Indigo, Sophisticated Lady. He played mostly piano, but he claimed that his instrument was actually his band. Duke Ellington connected with Bubba Miley in the 1920s, and he helped Ellington create his signature sound. The amount of musicians that they started using was increasing, and they actually in 1933, in that summer, did their first European tour with his band. Let's listen to this example by Duke Ellington called East St. Louis, Toodle-oo. For our second example of this early jazz band style of Duke Ellington, let's listen to his famous piece, Mood Indigo. By the late 1930s, the Ellington Band had established a fairly standard instrumentation of about 16 members. He also added some very critical people with the bassist Jimmy Blanton and tenor saxophonist Ben Webster. And by 1939, Billy Strayhorn was also joining the group as a musical arranger, lyricist, and composer for the band. Thank you for taking time to review this introduction to jazz in the 20s and our third part of Jazz from Its Origins to the Present.